relationships.
This is how we think of love is messed up. And this is the Sisyphus guy. I've been following him on and off. We all know he's going through an existential crisis, which we love for him, and we're wishing him the best through it. Existential crises are hard. And I definitely want to get into this. Before we do, Discord says, I have a personal experience with that. I grew up never really having a clean home, but now when I have experienced clean homes, I've realized how nice and good for my mental health it is. I'm not really there, but I'm in the process. We'll see how well the change is being adapted. I paraphrased that sentence. Sorry, I hear you. But like, yes, that's the thing too. Like, okay, so I'm a clutter fiend. I have like organized mess vibes, but also like my space is really cluttered all the time. And so I'm like, okay, Brittany, how do we challenge this clutter? Because like, I don't like it. It makes me feel overwhelmed and it makes me want to just do this so I don't even notice it. Like, I know I'm moving in the next, after this lease, we're most likely moving. So we're all looking to where we want to move, me and Mark. And I'm looking at my, like, okay, I have like these two closets. Everything I own is basically in this room. How do I get it down to the bare minimum slash how many things do I have that I don't even need? Guys, I went and cleaned out my closet the other day and I somehow came away with like a bag of trash. And it ended up being things like battery cases or, you know, receipts or things I just didn't need that I'd put in my closet thinking I could need this later. And so it's like I need to declutter. But I know the standard of clean some people live in, I will never be clean enough for them. But I also know my standard of clean might be too clean for somebody else. Like my sister doesn't like pets in the house. And so when she comes to visit, she's always like, the house feels dirty because you have a cat, because you have a dog. The house is dirty in some ways because I live with a bunch of boys. And then in some ways it's dirty because I'm just like dirty to some extent. So I've been thinking about that. Like I love daily showers, right? I love taking care of my hair. I love taking care of my body. I love taking care. But then what ways am I failing as a person? Or in what ways am I just like, this is just who I am? And the person, there is going to be a person out there who doesn't think I'm clean enough for them. Like, I've been thinking about that so much. So says, clutter makes me so anxious. Yeah, there is something anxious inducing about it, right? Like, I look at my desk and my brother just put it together for me. Cute. And I still haven't organized it. It's been here a few weeks. I can't tell if I just get overwhelmed or if my spoons leave or what it is. But I haven't done it yet. And I really am looking forward to organizing it. But then maybe I will never organize it because I'm not sure that I'm even that organized. My dad was like that, is like that. He's such an organized mess. And my mom is very, very, very clean. Like very, my mom is so clean, I'll never be that clean. But my dad and I are similar where we're hygiene clean, like very, we're very into our bodies and our hair being clean. But our office spaces are basically like cluttered messes. I am my father's daughter.
Can be tricky. Many spend their days dreaming about finally meeting that so-and-so who will justify their existence and fill that hole in their heart. Most of our media is characterized by the romantic pursuit, portraying love as a battleground of risk, hope, and making someone your everything. And much of our free time is filled up with swiping on dating apps, going out to bars and clubs, and talking about our romantic interests. All in the openly cynical and yet privately hopeful possibility of finding love. And then, once you're in it, at least 50% of the time, it becomes an uneven affair of hurt feelings and missed expectations. You engage in the desperate mental gymnastics of someone trying in their earnest to find a reason to stay, to somehow turn a blind eye to the possibility that this just isn't working out. Simone de Beauvoir, the famous existentialist author, wrote extensively about the asymmetrical expectations that characterize many relationships. She believed love to be an inherent component to the human condition. We wish to be with another, to be heard, to be affirmed in who we are. And yet, time and time again, this very desire leads us astray, into relationships that scar us and make us forget who we truly are. For Beauvoir, this common occurrence only further justifies the necessity of a sort of ethics of love, a project that she would pursue throughout her life. Today's video is sponsored by Blinkist. Sometimes I need to pore over quite a few books before I can decide on a topic for a video. Research can also be quite difficult since I need the time to retire books and, more importantly, powerful ideas into just 15 minutes of the most important highlights. Blinkist lets you save time, money, and helps you discover and understand the world around you faster than ever. Blinkist has over 3,000 nonfiction books, 14 million active users, and lets you access all of your titles while offline. Mm-hmm. Now there's also their podcasts to the heart of the interpretation of dreams, popular ideas, and would highly recommend it to anyone interested in the history of it. You'll also get...
It's the longest ad ever, bro.
Beauvoir saw the very ambiguity of love as a gateway to exploitation. This is apparent in the gender differences that define love. Boys, generally speaking, were encouraged to have projects for their lives, to see love as part of life, not all of it, and to believe that success was possible in more than one part at once. Girls, by contrast, were encouraged to see love as life itself, and to believe that to succeed at other things might make them less lovable.
I don't know if you guys know this, but my dad always tells me he raised me as a boy. And I didn't really understand what that meant totally. As I got older, it becomes more and more clear that this is sort of a part of it where some of the women in my circles legit, I'm not exaggerating, didn't go to college because they knew they were going to get married in their early 20s. Versus my family growing up, like, I never had this illusion or this idea that I was going to get married in my early 20s. It was possible for me because it was happening all around me, but it wasn't really possible for me. And so that could just be the way that I was raised, but that also maybe that, like, I was always, I don't know how many times my dad has told me, like, Betsy, who you can't work for people, you got to work for yourself. Like, you're your own boss, you have that energy, you know you're not going to make it in an office. And I'm like, true. Which means I'm not going to make it in a traditional marriage. So I was taught and given much more hope, I guess, because I was taught, like, I'm going to have a job and a business. I'm going to be a provider, or not a provider. Like, I wasn't told I was going to be the breadwinner. I just made that decision in my 20s, like, to some extent, to be like, okay, I'm just going to make either as much money as my partner and we're going to be equal, or one of us is going to make more money and focus on that, and one person's going to stay at home. We're just going to make it work, whatever works. So I think this is interesting, but I do meet women who genuinely have no aspirations for more because they don't have to, right? Kevin O'Leary just said this on Impulsive, where he said the worst thing you can do to a kid or to a man or to a woman is to take away the hardship of life, the suffering, because they have to know that there's something they have to work towards to feel like great purpose. So what you're doing is you're stealing people's purpose from them by giving them too much, you know, not letting them earn it. And so whether women are earning love or men are earning money, whether or not we're earning our place in the world, right? We're looking and we're solidifying our purpose. We're like fulfilling our purpose. And I think that is so interesting to me, I guess. Like, it was, I had a thought, but I'm not gonna share it. No.
Whereas men see freedom as their true calling, whatever that calling may be, women are taught to see love as their key to freedom. This naturally leads to some level of asymmetry in romantic expectations. Men have been generally taught to seek their romantic interest as somebody who will vitalize them and challenge them, unlocking their true potential, but nonetheless submitting to the man's power. They appear to provide almost mystical help to the man, reminiscent of the popular stock character of the manic pixie dream girl, who acts as a quirky, attractive, and spontaneous woman who encourages the male protagonist through their resistant and yet yielding validation of the man's true essence. We can see this trope in Breakfast at Tiffany's and a deconstruction of this trope in 500 Days of Summer. Beauvoir quite poignantly defines this issue early on. The average Western male's ideal is a woman who freely submits to his domination, who does not accept his ideas without some discussion, but who yields to his reasoning, who intelligently resists, but yields in the end. This, of course, isn't limited to one gender or the other, but is rather the norm as presented in media. The manic pixie dream boy is also a common trope. For both genders, Beauvoir, as well as a list of many other thinkers, discourages us from viewing love and relationships as the key to salvation. We should not rely on another to make us feel whole. Like money, material goods, social approval, and countless other culturally constructed ideas that promise us freedom or happiness, treating love as a means to an end will more often than not lead to an unsatisfactory relationship. This argument is brought forth in Becker's The Denial of Death, who...
for all y'all calling me a manic pixie girl, yeah, you and Destiny say the same thing. You know what's so funny? Is I am a manic pixie girl and I know it, but I don't just want to be the inspiration for my protagonist's, like, life. I think I'm the protagonist, maybe? I don't know, I can't tell, but it is true. And I do love playing that role of, like, facilitating their success, which is so interesting, because I'm not much of a team player. But I like that Lenora says, Brittany is a manic pixie dream girl for us all. Thank you. I don't know. There is something, like, I like that he said that there's also boys who are manic pixie, because, like, I meet those too. It's not, I don't want to date a manic pixie. Funny enough. But I don't even mind being categorized as one. Like, Destiny said that, right? That I have all these, like, checklists that make girls, like, unlikable. I can see that. This trope does not help.
Sees the age of secularism as becoming increasingly reliant on romantic relationships, as fulfilling our two ontological motives of feeling special and unique and also belonging to something larger. Whereas God used to give us the assurance that we are valued.
Miss Alyssa says, Brittany encourages us to be our own manic pixie dream girls. Exactly.
And good, we now seek such fulfillment in another human. The only issue is that they too are human, with their own quirks and existential anxieties. Such relationships often end in resentment or boredom, serving only to distract individuals from facing their fear of meaninglessness and death head on. What might these unhealthy relationships look like? Beauvoir presents us with two forms of failed love, narcissism and devotion. The relationship of narcissism, quite plainly, is loving oneself and loving in the other the love they have for you. This is apparent in the manic pixie dream girl fantasy of the man, who likes the idea of their partner and enjoys the encouragement and validation that comes with being with them. This fulfills the ontological motive of feeling unique and special. However, their lover is still nothing more than a small character in their life story. They neglect the fact that there is another in the relationship, with their own potential and good waiting to be encouraged and cultivated. Simply put, the narcissistic relationship is self-serving and dehumanizing. It often ends in the other feeling neglected and unwanted. On the other hand is devotion. If narcissism is making your partner into a side character in your life journey, devotion is letting your partner write that story for you. This is apparent in the love is everything fantasy socialized in girls, where the other is to be treated with the utmost devotion and given total autonomy. The devoted is there to serve the other entirely and acts as a gift to the lover. This fulfills the ontological motive of belonging to something larger. How special is it that this person has chosen you? You may even believe that it's meant to be, slowly forgetting yourself in the attempt to maintain a relationship that is anything but destined. Instead, you continually make compromises, allowing your true love to slowly define who you are, thus making it ever the more difficult to leave. You have made them your everything. Each side, both narcissism and devotion, is present in any relationship. To like someone a bit too much, or to also want some space, isn't unnatural. But Beauvoir is addressing the issue when these turn pathological. Neither is true love, but rather reflections of individuals who do not know themselves quite enough. Neither may be acting maliciously, but the damage can be nonetheless tremendous. Ethical love, then, is an equilibrium, a balance between absolute self-interest and absolute selflessness. As Beauvoir notes, it is to simply walk side by side, mutually helping each other a little. We give ourselves, but without losing ourselves. We share each other's lives all the while, respecting the fact that the good you see in the other cannot be restricted, but should rather be free to grow unencumbered by your own idealistic expectations. You love them for who they are. This can, of course, be corrupted when one sees the other as inferior or superior. And so a healthy relationship is one that is based upon and driven by a sense of equality and a shared sense of support. Despite her concerns with hetero relationships, I don't feel like the essence of Simone de Beauvoir's project of ethical love is exclusive to the love between a man and a woman. Instead, I believe that to strive for something she sees as both rare and yet possible, of a love in which both partners are equal, is a project relevant in any space where human connection is yearning to flourish.
Okay, what are our thoughts? It's interesting because... I struggle with this. Like, this is... Love is always so interesting. Love. What does it mean to love? I know I'm going to work on a podcast about love coming up, but... I think people get too hung up on all of it. Like, they get too hung up on the whole, we're equal, blah, blah, blah. And then they get too caught up on... I think there's just... Hold on. There's just too many kinds of love and marriage and cohabitation. This happens on our Discord all the time where we'll share our love preferences, how we date, all these things. And it's so clear that we all do it so differently. And there's nothing technically wrong with any of it. Like... Some of it I would have issues with in my bubble because, like, we all live in bubbles, right? Like, there are certain things a person could do to me. You guys know I don't tolerate cheating, right? I tried in the past to, like, take someone back and try it again, and it didn't really work. And I don't foresee it working in the future, and I don't really want to play that game. I'd rather just have, like, an open and communicative, like, relationship, and then we can talk about it because I'm not threatened by my partner wanting to engage with other people, like, generally speaking. But I can understand how for some people that's not what they want at all, period, the end, no caveat, no, like, leeway, no more. But love is there. Actually, oh, my reading voice is not great. I was gonna... Okay, listen to some of this. Okay, this is from the Ken Love Last book, The Fate of Romance Over Time. Okay, it says, George sought treatment because of intense unhappiness in his marriage of 10 years. Although he loved his wife and his young child, he had come to regard his wife as unbearably controlling and to feel claustrophobically trapped. Her various demands, such as an insistence on his calling to let her know when he would be late for dinner, had come to feel intolerably coercive. He found sexual liaisons, oh my gosh, guys, the dyslexia, the stuttering. He found sexual liaisons with other women irresistible and felt increasingly disaffected from his wife. With some embarrassment, George eventually revealed that among the most intense of his sexual adventures were regular visits to several madams who played the role of dominatrix with him. In these encounters, he would place himself totally in the women's hands. She would order him around, tie him up, and do anything that she wanted. He would beg and plead for mercy and release to no avail. Although there are rarely any genital contact or orgasms, George found these encounters extraordinarily thrilling. I was struck by the odd irony of a man who found his wife's demand for common courtesy oppressive, placing himself under the control of a virtual stranger. George explained that the women's control was a dramatic fiction. The way it worked with this sort of relationship was that they would establish a code word before beginning, a safe word. He would beg and scream for mercy without effect, but if he said the code word, the play would stop instantly. He was really in total control, and it was that complete power that made it impossible for him to pretend that the woman was ever in control. As we came to understand it, the control George resented from his wife was a control he longed for and yet was terrified he would... As we came to understand it, the control George resented from his wife was a control he longed for and yet was terrified he would surrender himself to. Because he actually depended on his wife for so much, even minor concessions like a phone call seemed too dangerous. He would only let himself surrender in a perversely contrived scenario to someone with whom he had nothing at stake with. Much later, I asked him how he was so sure that the dominatrix would, in fact, comply with the code word. Of course, there was an economic power as a background factor, but there seemed to be a leap of faith involved as well, one that he carefully did not notice. Even financial dominance is complex, and a desire is always risky. Actual as opposed to fantasized control is difficult to come by. He believed he was in control, imagining himself under her control. But from another perspective, he was under her control, imagining himself to be in control in order to pretend that he was surrendering. Because human relationships are built around such complex interdependencies, control and predictability often take on this sort of nesting doll quality. Oh, guys, this book is so fun. I'm sorry that I'm such a bad reader out loud, but it's Can Love Last? The Fate of Romance Over Time by Stephen A. Mitchell. He's a psychoanalyst, and it's a simple book. I'm not yet reading anything I haven't read before quite, but the way he puts it together is actually quite digestible, and so I recommend it. But this is the games we play with ourselves, right? This is why BDSM has been such a great adventure for me, because BDSM allows a space to occur in which you do not feel in control, so you give it up to somebody else so they can take control of you to help you cope or move through something or maybe express yourself in a different way. But the truth is, they don't have power over you, but they do. As an example, let's say I was tied up and I was on a St. Andrew's cross, and I think I have control because I could just say a safe word, red, and the scene would end. But I'm not actually in control because the person who's tied me up really is in control, and they have to be the person who unties me if I can't get out myself, right? But at the same time, if they're a good person and we're good people and we're doing a scene of good people, then they're going to listen to my safe word, and therefore I'm secretly in control. So in BDSM, when we bring newbies in, we always tell people, the real secret is that the bottoms are the most in control. But the real, real secret is that no one is, that all of us are taking a risk of being susceptible in that moment, whether we're tops or bottoms, to possibly hurting each other or ourselves. And I think that risk is worth it if it's something that is mutually explored by both parties. So instead of thinking that one person has to do one thing and one person has to do another, though that's really helpful in terms of goal setting and stuff like that and planning, I think instead we should play to each other's strengths and see what happens, see what we can create from that strength. And I think that that's what's missing in most relationships. I am not shocked that people don't talk to their partners, but I am shocked when I hear modern people who claim to be great at communication. I think it's cute when they're really bad at it. I'm not perfect at it. I have my moments. But one of the things that I practice in my communication style, at least as of right now, and this is new to me, is bluntly honest statements, which is so uncomfortable because you're thinking, oh God, I don't want to say it this way. And then they're going to think I'm this kind of a girl. And then they're going to not want to date me. But the truth is that if they hear you and understand you, they're also going to know why you're doing that. So I found that in the past, I would do things to check the consent of my partners. And if they couldn't quite hear me, they'd think that sometimes I was infantilizing them. But then if they can hear me, they're seeing that I'm actually just making sure that I'm not doing anything wrong, because according to my values and theirs, because I don't want to hurt my partner. So when people are checking in with you, sometimes it is because they're manic and fearful and they're insecure and it's almost too much. And then sometimes it's a mixture of both, where it's hey, I'm really confident, but I just want to make sure you're doing good. And then it's a little bit of, hey, I think you're doing good. Yeah, but I just want to check. It's there's an insecurity there that exists. And this relationship, as I learn about George and I think about his life, there's almost a claustrophobia to the way that it's, the claustrophobia is almost too, it's so clear on the paper to me that, he used the word too, but he feels suffocated by his own life. But I have little to no sympathy for him, because I'm you chose that life. You chose that wife. You chose to have kids. I don't really understand. I understand how you can be claustrophobic to your own choices, in relation to your own choices. I just want to encourage people, if they feel so inclined, when you read this and you think, could I be a George? Have that conversation with yourself, because I know way too many couples who come to me. I knew this Christian woman who's married for many, 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 many years. And her husband was so dependent on her, so adolescently dependent on her, that he wouldn't even make his own coffee. He needed her to help her with laundry. She couldn't go visit her friends for more than a couple of days because he'd be like, no, how can I make coffee and how can I do things? So then she'd make little baggies for him to make sure that he could do it. And the dilemma is that I couldn't tell from the outside what he was on about, but he would also do things make her. They come from a really weird Christian bubble where women can't get divorced. And so he would have make her, like, they would have sex in the elevator, and he would brag about it, like, yeah, we had sex in the elevator. But to her, it was, like, mortifying and basically, like, assault. Like, I don't even want to have sex in the elevator, but to be a good Christian wife, I have to do what he wants, right? And I'm just sitting here, like, this is, I'm getting fucking, like, I'm going to go crazy. Like, I can't, I just, I, but I get it. I get being in situations with a person you love more than anything, and they're telling you it's going to be okay, it's going to be great, it's going to be hot and sexy, let's just do it, let's just do it, let's just do it. I understand that. That's, like, really relatable. But to actually marry that or be with that for a long time, I mean, now I couldn't do something like that, I think. I hope not. I hope I don't fall for it. Like, that's what's scary, is I actually don't want to be in a toxic relationship. I'm trying really hard to avoid them. It's really hard, though, when you're learning someone for the first time and getting to know them, and you're just, like, sitting there and looking at them like, I hope you're who you say you are. Like, that's why I'll take an authentic, blunt sneako over a guy who might be, like, worrying about my feelings all the time. Like, yes, consider my feelings, but don't lie to me in the name of considering my feelings. You know what I mean?